What's up, everyone? In this video, I'm going to be discussing the basics of different web technologies. So maybe you want to get into web development and you want to understand the technologies behind it. This video is for you. If you already know about all these technologies, it's not going to be a helpful video for you. But if you want to see something more in depth about a specific technology, let me know in the comment section below and I'll make sure to make a video on it. Okay, so let's get straight into what is a web server. So what is a web server? Well, it can actually refer to two different things, the physical web server itself and the web server software. So a physical web server is literally just a computer, but it's more specialized and designed to serve up web pages. Now, web server software is the actual software that's on the web servers that actually handle each individual web request. So for instance, you'll see on screen a bunch of different things. So first is the client server model. So the client is your web browser. So something like Google Chrome, Safari, Internet Explorer.
Who uses Internet Explorer?
Anyway, so those are your clients. And when you actually request data from the server, that's the server side. So client and server. So you'll have to know that in this video, and I'll be discussing this in more detail in a little bit. So that's how the client server model works. So essentially what this is you'll have the physical web server that has an operating system on it, just like any other computer. It might be Linux, it might be Mac OS, and it might be Windows. And then you'll have web server software installed on top of that. So a common one is Apache HTTPD because it's free. Now there's also Microsoft IIS, which I believe is only available for Microsoft Windows Server. And it just depends on which technology you want to go with. And there's also alternatives to both of those as well. What's a web development stack, you might be asking? Well, it's essentially just a group of technologies that's used to create a website. So common bundles include Mongo, Express, Angular, and Node, also known as Mean. There's Linux, Apache, MySQL, and then PHP or Python, which is LAMP. Windows, Apache, MySQL, and PHP is WAMP. And then Linux, Apache, MySQL, and Ruby is LAMR. So when we talk about a web development stack, it can mean different things to different people. But generally, the common definition includes the web server operating system, some web server software, a development for the database, and then some server-side programming. These are just some of the development stacks that you can use. You can switch out components. For instance, for LAMP, you might be using PHP or you might be using Python. You might have a LAMP server and instead you're using Ruby, which is essentially what LAMR is. So it's really about picking out the technology that works for your website or your web app, depending on what you want to do. You can actually purchase web hosting that includes all these technologies bundled together. So for instance, there's LAMP and LAMR host that come in an all-in-one solution. And common solutions include HostGator, Bluehost, and GoDaddy. And if you want a WAMP solution, which is, once again, Windows, Apache, MySQL, and PHP, you can go with GoDaddy. Now, I believe Bluehost and HostGator may or may not have a shared hosting plan that also uses WAMP, but you'll have to check out that individual company's website for more details. Now, what is HTTP? You might have seen it in a link before, and you might be saying, I don't know what that means. Well, it actually stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. Now, what's a protocol? A protocol is essentially a standard used with computers and different technologies in order to communicate with each other. It's kind of like how we have English, we have Spanish, we have French, we have Cantonese, we have all these different languages, right? But if you're not speaking the same language, you won't get very far. So if I talk to someone in Spanish and they reply in German, I'm not going to be able to understand unless I also happen to know German. So that's kind of what a protocol handles. So HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol, and it's a standardized way for transferring website data. It handles requests and then responds with data. So for instance, you might make an HTTP request to a server, and then it responds with different website information. So some common HTTP requests include GET requests, which are used to receive content. So when you're opening a web page and you're going to Google, you're making a GET request. A POST request is generally used to make new content. A PUT request, while not done directly in the browser necessarily, is used to update existing content. Also, there's the DELETE request type, which is used to delete content. So it's pretty straightforward. You have GET, which gets content, POST creates content, PUTTING is updating, and then DELETE deletes content. It's pretty straightforward. I could do a whole video on REST APIs and things like that, talking about this in more detail, but that's all you need to really know for now. The idea is that you make a request and then the web server responds. And then this response includes header information, so status codes. So if you've ever heard of 404 not found, that's an example of an HTTP status code. And then if it needs to serve up a web page, it'll respond with some website content as well. Okay, now what is HTML? HTML stands for Hypertext Markup Language, and it's the markup language behind every single website. HTML consists of different HTML elements, such as images, paragraphs, video players, and other items on a web page. So on the right, you'll see if you type some HTML, so this is an example of a link. If I type out ahref equals quotation marks and then a link to Google, and then type click here to go to Google, it'll get rendered as a link. So that's what HTML is. It's the code that actually generates the web page. Now let's talk about styling here, specifically cascading style sheets, which is what CSS is. Now CSS is actually used to style elements on a web page. I'm talking content placement, color of the text, width, padding, margins, and other things like that. So on the left, you'll have some CSS. So if I target the H1 element, and then if it has a class of black, it's going to change the color to black and it's going to underline the text. Now I'm going to do h1.hover-pink and then colon hover. Now what this does is it selects the h1 element that meets this criteria. So .hover-pink, which means h1 with a class of hover-pink. And then when you hover over, it's going to change the text to be pink and it's going to remove the underlining. So if you look at the right, you'll have some HTML. So essentially what you're doing is you're creating some CSS and HTML. The HTML is the actual markup of the elements. The CSS is used to style it. So if this were to be rendered, you would have a link that is black and is underlined. And when you hover over it, it'll change to pink and remove the underlining. What is client-side programming? It's programming for the client side. So in our instance, our client is our web browser. So if you have a web page that's already been loaded and you want to manipulate that content, you might want to drag and drop. You might want to make a request to a server without having to reload a web page. If you've gone on Twitter, if you've gone on Google, if you browse the internet, odds are you've seen a website that utilizes JavaScript, okay? So JavaScript is an example of client-side programming. It's used to manipulate the web page after it's already been loaded. All right, so what's JavaScript and does it have anything to do with Java? Short answer, essentially no. It doesn't have anything really to do with Java. It does share some of the common C syntax and they use similar naming conventions, but other than that, they're not related. So as you can see, I found this little cool cartoon and it says JavaScript sounds like it has something to do with Java. It doesn't. In fact, Java is to JavaScript as ham is to hamster. They're not related. Just like you can have a car and you can have carpet. You can have carpet in your car, but other than that, they're really not related. Now, as I believe I mentioned earlier, JavaScript is a client-side programming languages. Now there are some new exceptions to this because there are new technologies coming out such as React. There's things like Node.js that are using JavaScript on the server side. But in general, in the traditional sense, JavaScript is strictly a client-side programming language. So that's it for JavaScript. What does server-side mean?
Surprisingly, it means code that's written for servers. Who would have thought, huh?
So how this works is a client sends a request to a server. Now, someone will write some server code that actually processes that request. It'll eventually pop back to the user's client as HTML and is sent to the user. So for instance, if you're logging into a web page, you're going to send an HTTP request to a server. That server is going to take your username and password that you just entered, process it through some code, and then spit it back out a response as HTML to the user. So examples of these server-side programming languages include PHP, which is my personal favorite right now, and it has been for, 9 years now, Python, Ruby, and there's a ton more as well. Those are just popular ones. Like I said, JavaScript can also be used for server-side using Node, but that's a whole nother video topic on its own. Okay, so what's a database? And database is an organized collection of data. So things like web apps, phone apps, and others utilize a database. If you're on this video right now, you queried a database to get to this video. Okay, so with a database, you have a database management system. This is software that's used to actually interact with the database. Now, there's a ton of different solutions on the market, but these are just some common ones. Common ones include MySQL, MongoDB, Oracle, and then Microsoft SQL Server. Now, SQL or SQL is a commonly used language for storing and retrieving data through a database management system. Not all database management systems utilize SQL, but a lot of them do. Examples of database management systems that utilize SQL include MySQL, Oracle, and then Microsoft SQL Server. Not all database management systems utilize SQL, so MongoDB uses BSON, which is a completely different syntax altogether. And I could do a video just on MongoDB if I wanted to. It's important to note that while you are writing SQL code, you can't necessarily take code that you wrote for MySQL database management system and then just pop it into Microsoft SQL Server and expect it to run properly. Now, if you're doing basic things like just selecting and things like that, sure, you can do it. But if you're doing more complicated things with your queries and creating views and stuff, the SQL syntax will vary a little bit. So don't just expect to be able to change from MySQL to Microsoft SQL Server overnight. All right, so that's it for this video. If you found it helpful, make sure to let me know by leaving me a comment in the comment section below. Make sure to like this video to let me know you want to see more content like this one. Subscribe to be notified for new content regarding web development and more. Hope you guys enjoyed this video, and until next time, I will catch you guys later.